of Tyndale House. It is a remarkable evangelical study center emphasizing biblical studies and Christian ethics right here in Cambridge, not very far at all, just a pleasant walk from Robinson College. This is a remarkable study center. They have an amazing library of original sources and secondary sources on biblical studies and theology in general. And it's a powerful, powerful library. People come to this place from all over the world to study here, and they currently are able to have, I think, north of 50 people in residence at a time. It's not a large place, but it's they get a lot of action out of their size. For those of you who, like me, are kind of college and university junkies, you get a rush walking in that library, let me tell you. It's really pretty cool. Peter Williams has been the warden of Tyndale House now for about 7 years, and he's doing a great, great job. I'm just very, very impressed at his dedication to building this wonderful resource for the Christian church. He holds master's degrees and the PhD in New Testament from Cambridge. He's an affiliated lecturer in the University of Cambridge Faculty of Divinity. He's an honorary senior lecturer in biblical studies at the University of Aberdeen. He's the chair of the International Greek New Testament Project. He's the author or editor of 5 books in biblical studies. And he really loves the Lord, and he's a great speaker to have with us. Will you join me in welcoming Dr. Peter Williams?
Well, good morning. It's really great to be here. Lovely to come to a place that's just 15 minutes walk from my house. So I set off from Tyndale House this morning and was able to be with you. Now, I need a bit of help. I was playing with my children in the sea the other day and lost my watch. So maybe at 12:15, quarter past 12, quarter after 12 in some of your languages, if lots of people could just start waving their hands, that would be great. And then I'll wind up about 8 minutes after that. What I'm going to share with you is just a little bit about what C.S. Lewis had to say on the subject of friendship, and quite a lot on what the Bible has to say, because I know more about the Bible than I do about Lewis. But let's start with thinking about friendship today. It's rather a major theme. Every salesman, it seems, wants to be your friend. Friendship is seen as essential to marketing, to fundraising, to evangelism, and to social networking generally. Friendship is talked about a lot. Of course, the word friend gained a lot of new currency in the year 2004 when Facebook was founded, and it really burst onto the scene as Facebook exploded in 2008. Despite rumors of a slowdown in Facebook and that the young are abandoning it, the largest group still on Facebook are 16 to 25-year-olds. Approximately 15% of the world's population are users, and a very high proportion of the Western world. Of course, then, the word friend got rather overplayed, didn't it? So in 2011, they introduced close friends and acquaintances, and many of us are registered as having very large numbers of friends indeed. So you might be able to count your Facebook friends, but in terms of real friends, I don't think we're in a very different situation from the time of Scipio Africanus the Younger, who is alleged to have said that while everyone could tell you how many goats and sheep he had, he was unable to tell you the number of his friends. Ancient classical writers wrote about friendship, the virtue of philia. Aristotle wrote on philia in his books on ethics, and then his pupil Theophrastus of Eresus, wrote about friendship in 3 volumes, which sadly don't survive. But what we do have is we have some quotations from other people of what they said. So if we want for something that will survive from the ancient world to learn about ethics, we might want to go to Aristotle, we might want to go to Cicero, who in fact wrote a whole treatise on this called De Amicitia. The way Cicero portrayed friendship is rather than just give you an abstract treatise on friendship, and that might make you yawn, he decided he was going to portray two different individuals and how they had had a friendship together. And he uses one of those as a mouthpiece to speak about what friendship is. And one of the things that comes through in Cicero is that friendship, real friendship, is rare. And that's going to be an important theme, because that is also something I think you can see within writings of Lewis and within the Bible. Rare, but exceedingly valuable. One of Cicero's characters, Laelius, describes it as life's best furniture. And he actually uses the word supellex, which is, you know, furniture in someone's house, and says that is the best furniture you can have. I just thought I'd leave that with you. But if we're going to think about C.S. Lewis, what did C.S. Lewis have to say about friendship? Well, of course, you all know that the obvious place to go to C.S. Lewis on friendship is his book, The Four Loves, because there he has a whole chapter on friendship, and he formally treats it as a virtue. Well, I'm not going to talk about the obvious place to go, because why would I want to reiterate less eloquently what he said more eloquently? If you want to read that, just go and read it. That's fine. What I want to do is think about something else that C.S. Lewis said about friendship. Lewis began his book, The Last Battle, with a depiction of Shift the Ape and Puzzle the Donkey. The opening page in almost any edition will say this: Shift had one friend and neighbour who was a donkey called Puzzle. At least they both said they were friends, but from the way things went on, you might have thought Puzzle was more like Shift's servant than his friend. That's the opening page of chapter one. Let's go to the opening page of chapter two. King Tyrion is sitting under the great oak. In the opening page, there was no one with him that spring morning except his dearest friend, Jewel the Unicorn. They loved each other like brothers and had saved each other's lives in the wars. So Lewis is highlighting in the narrative that there are friends and friends. It's a tale of two friendships. As Tyrion is sitting there, along comes the dryad of a beech tree, bemoaning the felling of the trees in Lantern Waste. Shortly after, Runewit the centaur arrives and tells of the terrible conjunctions of the stars in the heavens. Tyrion is so angry he wants to go straight to Lantern Waste. Come, friends, he says, we must go upriver. Runewit demurs and is sent off to Caer Paravel for reinforcements. On their way, Tyrion has a foreboding that he shares with Jewel. It says he leaned hard on his friend's neck. They arrived at Lantern Waste. Tyrion, in his anger, kills a Calormene and has to flee. On my back, said Jewel. The king flung himself astride his old friend, who turned and galloped away. They get away. Jewel asks where they should go next. Whither, sire? Hold hard, friends, said Tyrion, and announces his plan to go back. He returns, expecting and asking to see Aslan. But he sees just the ape, who is in conversation and talking about a deal he's just made with the king of Calormen, the Tisrock, as our dark-faced friends, the Calormenes, call him. The lamb speaks up. How could Aslan's people make a deal with the Calormenes? They follow Tash. He says, I don't believe that there is any such person as Tash. But if there was, how could Aslan be friends with him? The ape ridicules him. Aslan and Tash, he says, are one and the same. The cat gets interested. Does your friend from Calormen say the same, he asks. Tyrion is tied up for the night, alone on a tree, tired and hungry. I mean, you all know this story, don't you? I'm just sort of abbreviating a bit, but read the real thing. tired and hungry and thirsty. Presently, six creatures, three mice, a rabbit, and two moles come and feed him. Little friends, says Tyrion, how can I thank you for all this? It will not be the last time that Tyrion will have six friends. Left alone, he remembers the children who helped Narnia in the past. Children, children, friends of Narnia, quick, come to me, he calls out. He's plunged into a dream and sees seven people seated at a table wearing odd clothes. That's British clothes, odd clothes, you see. One of the characters, Peter, rises and charges him to speak. We are the seven friends of Narnia. The word friend occurs at many significant places in the following narrative. And we notice how and I'm not going to go through them all, the phrase Tyrion and his friends begins to occur. Poggin the dwarf joins them, addressed as Friend Poggin. They see a bird overhead, a bird of prey. It's an eagle. But is it a friend or a spy of the apes? Asked Tyrion. Arrow on the string, lady, said Tyrion to Jill. But by no means shoot till I bid you. He may be a friend. Eventually, there are seven of them, and the seven friends go to Stable Hill. They fight the first lot of Calormenes and get them to go scampering back to their friends. Then they hear the drum sounding reinforcements. Tyrion says they must attack before yonder miscreants are strengthened by their friends. The fight begins, and slowly they are picked off until the seventh occurrence of the phrase Tyrion and his friends. And that seventh occurrence and the last one before he goes through the stable door, the last one before Narnia ends for him, it shows a little variation. It's not Tyrion and his friends anymore. It says, and now the leveled spears were closing in on Tyrion and his last friends. Next minute, they were all fighting for their lives. Well, you know the graphic way that he writes. He gets through the stable door into glorious day and meets the seven friends of Narnia. He asks, where is Queen Susan? My sister Susan, answered Peter, shortly and gravely, is no longer a friend of Narnia. Tyrion has the door explained to him and looks back through it into Narnia, through the keyhole. He then looks round at the blue sky and his new friends all round him laughing. They then try to make friends with the dwarfs. Lucy says, I've tried and tried to make friends with them, but it's no use. Friends with them, says Eustace, if you know how those dwarfs have been behaving. Then Aslan brings the whole world of Narnia to an end. The creatures come streaming through the door, some to Aslan's right, some to his left. Among the happy creatures who now came crossing round Tyrion and his friends were all those that they had thought dead. So this is the eighth occurrence because we're in the new world. They go further into the new world. They meet Emeth, a noble Calormene, whose name in Hebrew, by the way, means truth. Emeth says, I do not know whether you are my friend or my foe, but I shall count it my honour to have you for either. Has not one of the poets said? And there's some amazing Calormene poetry, isn't it? Someone needs to just bring that all together. Has not one of the poets said that a noble friend is the best gift and a noble enemy the next best? They go farther up and farther in until eventually Lucy stood with her dear friend, her oldest Narnian friend, the Fawn Tumnus. It's then that she finally realises that the inside is bigger than the outside and that she's part of a great story in which every chapter is better than the one before. Well, that was a rather quick run through the book. But these references to friend occur at significant points. The references are deliberate, and if you don't, you're not already convinced that they're deliberate as a conscious thematization of friend. Additional evidence would come from the chapter on friendship in The Four Loves, which on the opening page complains that people are not writing enough about the depiction of friendships in literature, in modern literature. The Last Battle uses the term friend more than any of the other chronicles, but throughout the chronicles it comes in prominent positions. Mr. Tumnus's job from the witch is, of course, to pretend to be friendly. He says to Lucy, I pretended to be your friend. Edmund is said to have made friends with the witch. And the horse and his boy, of course, ends with that phrase. Sorry, that's my wallet as well. Maybe we'll just get on the whole opening, final paragraph of The Horses and His Boys. It's just such a... Everyone know the... I mean, it's the one of the paragraphs that's really worth memorising from The Horse and His Boy, where, of course, what we have is Aravis, and what it says is... This is the last paragraph. I've got to do the whole thing. Aravis also had many quarrels, and I'm afraid even fights with Cor, but they always made it up again, so that years later, when they were grown up, they were so used to quarrelling and making it up again that they got married so as to do so more conveniently. And after King Lune's death, they made a good king and queen of Arkenland, and Ram the Great, the most famous of all the kings of Arkenland, was their son. Bri and Huin lived happily to a great age in Narnia and both got married, but not to one another. And there weren't many months in which one or both of them didn't come trotting over the pass to visit their friends at Anvard, Finnish book. Okay, that's how emphatic some of these positions are. We go to Prince Caspian. Dr. Cornelius, of course, says to Caspian, what friend have I in the world except your majesty? Caspian will later announce Dr. Cornelius as his greatest friend. Trumpkin the dwarf, much to his chagrin, gets called the DLF, the dear little friend. When Trumpkin finally meets Aslan, who he's not believed in up to this point, and Aslan throws him up in the air, catches him again and says, "Son of Earth, shall we be friends?" Nicobrick then conducts a seance with a hag and a werewolf. "These are friends of mine," he says, and we have there the densest passage in all of the Chronicles for talking about friends. The Voyage of the Dawn Treader, opening paragraph again of the Voyage of the Dawn Treader, is quite fun, isn't it? Maybe I won't read that to you, but you know how it begins, about Eustace Clarence Scrub. Sentence 3 of the book. "I can't tell you how his friend spoke to him, for he had none." And in that book, of course, Caspian is searching for the friends of his father. Perhaps Lewis was thinking there of Proverbs 27, verse 10. "Do not forsake your friend and your father's friend." Eustace gets turned into a dragon. He gets very lonely. His attitude changes, and it says he wanted to be friends. Time fails me to talk about Lucy eavesdropping on a school friend using the magician's book, and then the discussion of friendship with Aslan follows. In the silver chair, Jill gets told that Eustace will meet an old and dear friend, which means Caspian, and since they don't, they've bungled the first sign. At the end of the book, Eustace gets to say to Puddle Glum, "You've been the best friend in the world." We get to the end and we hear about Experiment House again, and that incompetent head, of course, 3 paragraphs before the end, the head's friends, when she gets sacked, manage to make her an inspector, and when she's no good at that, she gets made a politician. 2 paragraphs before the end, final sentence, and Jill and Eustace were always friends. So if you want to know what Lewis thought about friendship, then the Chronicles, alongside the Four Loves, will give us a very good picture. Now, one of the things he says in The Four Loves is that few value it because few experience it. So in other words, it's a rare thing. But he's given us in his Chronicles a vast array of friendships, some real and some sham. One of the principles also he outlines in The Four Loves is that lovers are face-to-face in Eros. They're facing towards each other, whereas friends sit alongside each other and view something else together. The 7 friends of Narnia are friends because they all look at Narnia. Tyrion fights alongside his friends together for Narnia. The dwarves, however, are for the dwarves. And so everything turns in on itself, and you find them ultimately fighting. They're not looking at anything outside. They're poor company to each other. Well, that's a brief view of some of the things that Lewis had to say. Let's now think about some things from the Bible. Well, I want to look at the word friendship in the Bible. Doesn't occur very much, so I can do that quickly. I'm going to look at the word friend and then one particular biblical friendship. When we consider the word friend in the Bible, we find it doesn't occur as many times as we might expect. In the Old King James Bible of 1611, it occurs 107 times. In the English Standard Version, 115. In the New International Version, 171 times. Recent translations tend to have a little bit more. The King James Version, therefore, has it about 137 words per million. Modern British English, typically 315 words per million. Classical Latin on the word amicus, about 525 words per million. In other words, 4 times the frequency of the word friend in the King James Version. The English translations, of course, represent several Hebrew and Greek words, and those words, in turn, don't just represent one concept each. They're used for a number of different relationships. But the word friendship is pretty rare. Friendship has been reified in our society. It's an abstract noun. There's little evidence of that going on in the Old Testament. But in the New Testament, there is the word philia, which occurs once. But funnily enough, it's not a virtue, as in Aristotle. It's a vice. James 4:4 says, "You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God." This profound verse deals with important aspects of the topic, namely the exclusivity of friendship. We know the difficulty of being friend to 2 people who don't get on well, but here the problem is not merely that the 2 parties, God and the world, don't get on well. That's just part of the picture. There's the language of adultery, which pushes it further. It's not merely that the two parties are opposed. Even if they were not opposed, it would not be possible to be friends of both. If you are a man or a woman under the glorious yoke of wedlock, that limits some of the friendships you may have. So if I'm overly friendly, even to my wife's best female friend, that's a problem, because friendship even has a possessive element. My wife has exclusive possession of me in some significant ways. And James 4:4 is interesting because it explicitly associates friendship and marriage. And since it's the only verse that speaks about philia in the Bible, that's rather striking. Now, what I want to do is I want to have a little look at the word marriage. You know there are some debates which are going on today about marriage in society and what legal provisions our countries should make for that. And one of the striking things about the word marriage, too, is that it only occurs probably one time in the Bible. Your English translation may have it more times, but in terms of a word that actually means that relationship, that state that exists between two people, it only occurs, arguably, in Hebrews 13, verse 4. Marriage is held in honor among all. There's the Greek word gamos. Sometimes the word will be used in translations to refer to the marriage of Cana in Galilee, but that means the wedding, doesn't it? Or a marriage feast or something like that. Now, what's happened with the word marriage is it's become rather abstracted, because it refers to a relationship between two people, and you can have a good marriage or a bad marriage. You can work on your marriage, or you can have marriage enrichment. Above all, you have a marriage. It's a possession you have, rather like a friendship now is seen as a possession you have. It's not that you're friends, you have a friendship. You work on your friendship, and so on. And so what's happened with both of these words is they have become commodities, things that you have. Of course, if you put it like that, why can't everyone have access to that commodity? Well, as I've been reflecting upon both marriage and friendship in the Bible, and there are some very significant differences, I think that in the case of marriage, it's not primarily about what the state declares or the church declares or about a ceremony or even about a covenant. The essence of what's going on in the heart of a marriage, although this is not a sufficient description, it is still a necessary one, is that the heart of the marriage is two people possessing each other. That's why, by the way, Greek and Hebrew, as many other languages, did not need a separate word for husband and wife. The word gets done by the possessive adjective, her man, his woman. And so there we see the possession very strongly placed. 1 Corinthians 7:4, for the wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. Likewise, the husband does not have authority over her own body, but the wife does. There is a major translation which regrettably says the wife does not have authority over her own body, but yields it to the husband in the same way the husband does not have the authority over his body, but yields it to the wife. But notice, by introducing the word yield, which is a paraphrase, you've actually moved the locus of possession from one person to the other. No doubt the translators had the best of motives. It's right to fear the abuse to which a text like that could be put when put in the hands of a physically abusive husband. That's a serious pastoral concern. But the answer is not softening up the translation, but trying to get to the grips of the conceptuality here. Of course, the possession of someone's body is not absolute. That person is not chattel. You have no more authority to damage that body than to damage a stranger's body. Just as in some parts of Cambridge, you can buy a house, if you've got enough money, freehold without the ability to cut down a tree, because we recognize that possession is rather complex. And so possession is very important. And I think that one of the key things we need to understand is not that you have a friendship or you have a marriage, but in fact that either of these things, you are possessed by someone else in a differing degree. So in my matrimony, I as a man am possessed by a woman, and only logically subsequently to that, from my perspective, do I possess her. From her perspective, she's possessed by me, and logically subsequent to that, from her perspective, she possesses me. And there's an offensiveness to that sort of talk, which may be rather interesting as we reintroduce it, because that's where I think we might want to go. Now to return to friendship. The application of friendship we find in James 4:4 points to the important possessive element in friendship too. The more friends you have, the more people possess you in some sense. That is, they have an access to you, not in an exclusive way, but they have access to your time. We might like to parse a phrase like his friend in a non-exclusive way. He may have 1,000 friends. That does not mean his friend can't have, it doesn't mean that they demand anything of him. If you make excessive demands on a friendship, it might well end the friendship. Well, I think that when we see the one occurrence of friendship in the Bible, we see that God really exclusively demands a loyalty, and that if we have friendship with the wrong entity, such as with the world, it can become a vice, not a virtue. Thinking about the word friend, and we'll spend a little bit more time on this. One of the surprises about the word friend and the way it's used in the Bible, about half the number of times in a modern English corpus, is we get the impression that although the Bible uses the word in many different ways, that there are some surprises. Let's think about the book of Proverbs. There's no wiser place to begin than that. The surprise in the book of Proverbs is that many of the references to friends are negative. Chapter 22, verse 24. Do not make friends with a hot-tempered person. Do not associate with one easily angered. There's a proverb telling you not to have friends with certain people. There is no proverb telling you to have friends with particular people. Or consider, the poor is disliked even by his neighbor, but the rich has many friends. Wealth brings many new friends, but a poor man is deserted by his friend. Many seek the favor of a generous man, and everyone is friend to a man who gives gifts. All a poor man's brothers hate him. How much more do his friends go far from him? He pursues them with words, but does not have them. Now, it's not an absolute statement that every case of friendship in the book of Proverbs is negative. It doesn't have to mean that a rich man having friends is necessarily negative, although I take it as negative, some people don't. But what we can see is that the poor does not seem to have friends very much. In other words, getting really decent friends, real friends, is a rare thing. This might help us appreciate the puzzling verse from Ecclesiastes 7:27-28. I wonder if you've ever puzzled about this one. Behold, this is what I found, said the preacher, adding one thing to another to find the scheme of things, which my soul has sought repeatedly, but I have not found. One man among 1,000 I found, but a woman among all these I have not found. Do you remember it? Anyone puzzled over that one in the past? Our minds are automatically struck by the asymmetry. We read this text as telling us that there are a few good men and no good women. So we're offended by the sexism, and therefore we don't listen to what it might be telling us. The insight of Dr. Catherine Dell of the university, just down at St. Catherine's College down the way, an expert in wisdom literature, may help here. In wisdom literature, wisdom is personified as a lady, Lady Wisdom. Also in wisdom literature, we have the theme that wisdom is really hard to find, something like Job 28. Dell has plausibly suggested that the woman whom the writer cannot find here is wisdom. Therefore, the meaning is not that wisdom, the lady, can never be found, but that she's even harder to find than a good man. And so the verse therefore implicitly tells us that it is hard to find a good man, a good friend, and wisdom is even harder to find. It's rather like the acrostic poem at the end of Proverbs, which tells you that finding a virtuous woman to wed is rather difficult. Who can find her? She is more precious than rubies. Now let's consider Proverbs 18, verse 24. A man of many companions will come to ruin, but there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother. The Hebrew translated a man of many companions is literally a man of friends. The translations render it as companions because they want to cast a negative effect. The Hebrew even has a word play. The word come to ruin and the word friend sound similar. But what we see is that in the second clause, there is a friend who sticks closer than the brother, it's used a less usual word for friend. It's used the one for someone who loves. And that person sticks very close, using the word stick or cleave, which occurs in Genesis 2, verse 24, for the husband and wife being joined. So there is a very close relationship, even if not one of the same physical intimacy. Another comparison we find between brothers and friends is in Proverbs 17. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. That sort of puts them on a par. Proverbs 27, do not forsake your friend or your father's friend, and do not go to your brother's house in the day of your calamity. Better is a neighbor, literally friend, who is near than a brother who is far away. So when we get brothers and friends put alongside each other, one case, brothers and friends are on a par. On two occasions, friends are actually better than brothers. But an interesting thing arises in my mind, and this may just be my imagination, because usually you don't have that many brothers. I know some of them had big families sometimes back then, but the very fact that brothers and friends are compared might give us some hint that having too many of them might not be the best thing. Let's go on to Psalms. Psalms has friends as a prominent theme, and the portrait is overwhelmingly negative. Consider the theme. Psalm 31. Because of all my enemies, I am the utter contempt of my neighbors and the object of dread to my closest friends. Those who see me on the street flee from me. Psalm 38. My friends and companions avoid me because of my wounds. My neighbors stay far away. Psalm 41. Even my close friends, someone I trusted, who has shared my bread, has turned against me. Psalm 55. If an enemy were insulting me, I could endure it. If a foe were rising against me, I could hide it. But it is you, a man like myself, my companion, my close friend, with whom I once enjoyed sweet fellowship at the house of God, as we walked together among the worshippers. Again, Psalm 55. My companion attacks his friends, he violates his covenant, and so on. 88. You have taken from me my closest friends and made me repulsive to them. You have taken from me my friend and my neighbor. Darkness is my closest friend. Psalm 109, in return for my friendship they accuse me, but I am a man of prayer. They repay me evil for good and hatred for my friendship. The key thing to notice in Psalms about friends is they let you down. That seems to be the theme that's coming through. Many of the Psalms are attributed to David, who experiences betrayal by some of his closest associates. This picture of the psalmist as someone betrayed fits not only with the life of David, it also fits with the life of Christ, whose betrayal and suffering many of us might see as foreshadowed in the Psalms. Particularly that Psalm 41, which is quoted in John 13. The one who eats bread with me has lifted up his heel against me, in the context of speaking about friends. Well, have I been overly negative in portraying friendship in the Bible by selecting two books which portray it negatively? Let's consider some other books. The book of Esther. It's the morally dubious Haman who has all of his friends around. The book of Job. We've all heard of Job's three friends who were not just three deficient friends he happened to have. Arguably, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar were his best friends, which is not much of an advertisement for friendship. In fact, Job as a book has one of the highest frequencies of the word friend. Jeremiah. Beware of your friends. Do not trust anyone in your clan, for every one of them is a deceiver, and every friend a slanderer. Friend deceives friend, and no one speaks the truth. They've taught their tongues to lie. They weary themselves with sinning. Lamentations, second verse. Bitterly she weeps all night. Tears are on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, there's no one to comfort her. All her friends have betrayed her. All her friends have betrayed her. They've become her enemies. Obadiah. All your allies will force you to the border. Your friends will deceive and overpower you. Those who eat your bread will set a trap for you, but you will not detect it. Micah, do not trust a neighbor. Put no confidence in a friend. Even with the woman who lies in your embrace, guard the words of your lips. Zechariah, if someone says, what are these wounds in your body? They will answer, the wounds I was given at the house of my friends. Zechariah 13:6. You get the picture? So the wounds there, I think, are given at the house of my friends, presumably are wounds given by the friends. That reminds us of a proverb I left out. Wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. Here, friendship is portrayed as something painful but valuable. Perhaps they rebuke you and it hurts, but it would be better to be wounded in that way than to have the flattery of an enemy. Of course, the kiss, pretending to be a friend, is no coincidence when we see how Judas betrays Jesus with a kiss. He pretended to be a friend. He was, in fact, an enemy. Is it a surprise, therefore, in Matthew 26, verse 50, that Jesus says, "Do what you came for, friend"? Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. There are good examples of friendship. The obvious one would be David and Jonathan in a positive relationship. It's very moving. Their friendship is even formalized in a covenant. And David will treat Jonathan's descendants well after he dies. Another good example of friendship would be the book of Ruth. Now, I said there was no reference to the abstract noun friendship in the Old Testament. That depends on what the name Ruth means. If Ruth is correctly understood to be from Ruth, meaning either female companion or possibly friendship, and the dictionaries disagree, the experts disagree, then we have actually an example of that. But certainly she is a very good friend. That would be an example of friendship in the Old Testament. So why does classical literature talk about friendship a lot and the Bible so little? Well, of course, one of the reasons could be that friendship can be either a commodity or a virtue. If it's a commodity, the Bible has absolutely no interest in it. It's the virtue that the Bible is interested in. The virtue of faithfulness, or even covenant faithfulness, which is such an important theme in the Bible that some theologians have even argued that it's the central theme of the Bible. And the virtue of God's faithfulness to covenant is brought out particularly in the case of God's relationship with Abraham. And the remarkable thing about Abraham is that Abraham is the only person in the Bible ever to get called God's friend. And it occurs thrice that he gets called God's friend. And so when only one person ever gets called God's friend, and it occurs three times, don't you want to sit up and listen and say, what's going on here? So this is, I am going to end on a more positive note, honest. Let's look at the three occurrences of the word friend of Abraham. Once is an occurrence in 2 Chronicles 20, verse 7, on the lips of King Jehoshaphat, when he's praying to God and mentions how Abraham was God's friend. Our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? So he uses the fact that Abraham is God's friend as part of his argument that God should answer the prayer. Isaiah, or as some of you would say, Isaiah, says in 41 verse 8, "But you, Israel, my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, you descendants of Abraham, my friend." That's God speaking himself. And then we have one occurrence in the New Testament. James, a careful reader of the Old Testament, says, "And the scripture was fulfilled," this is James 2:23. "Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend." Now, you might think of other occurrences where people are implied to be God's friend. For instance, Moses speaks face to face with God as one speaks to a friend, but it doesn't actually call Moses a friend. Another striking occurrence, don't use this at home, is when Jesus says to his disciples, "You're my friends if you do what I command." So, you know, that's not the way to make friends and influence people if you're us, if you see what I mean. But he says, "I no longer call you servants," this is John 15, "because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends, for everything I've learned from my Father, I've made known to you." So the essence of friendship there is, of course, sharing knowledge. That's a really key thing. You're not having lots of secrets from friends. But what we see with Abraham is that he is the only one who is described of as God's friend. Well, the question is this: why should God have so few friends? I mean, can Abraham's friendship with God help us understand more about God's relationship with him? Well, perhaps we can be helped by the phrase, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. What can we think about? What's it mean? Well, let's think of that of relationship again. Does it mean that the God Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are allowed to call on? They possess him in some way. He is of them. What can we say about these patriarchs? Did they have a claim on God? Let's press the question of friendship further. God has a lot of capacity. He's got skills at multitasking and infinite resources. So why should he just have one friend? Can we learn anything from like that? Or let's put it like this. God may only have one friend, but boy, did he do a good job of the friendship. I mean, think about what God did to Abraham in terms of how well he filled that friendship. He gave Abraham promises. He gave him land. He gave him offspring. He gave him material blessing. He blessed those who blessed him. He cursed those who cursed him. He made his descendants into a great nation. He guaranteed that every family on earth would be blessed through him. In other words, God changed the world through his friendship with Abraham. So for friendship to be transformative, it's not quantity of relationships, but quality. Now you might say, well, I'm not God, so I can't change the world. True. But you have access to God's grace and power. What if you poured that into one relationship? And doing so, when God was friends with Abraham, it didn't narrow the blessing so that only Abraham was blessed. Loads of people received benefits because God blessed Abraham and was a friend to him. Countless people have benefited because God was a really, really good friend to one person. Now, there are obvious differences with us, but there's something amazing about God's friendship with Abraham we can learn from. God was so faithful to Abraham, and Abraham experiences the full faithfulness of God. But while Abraham is said to be friend of God, God is never actually said to be friend of Abraham. And we need to think about that. Lewis solves that, but we'll deal with that in a minute. What we see, let's go to the book of Matthew. The book of Matthew begins, first verse, with Jesus Christ, son of David, son of Abraham. And so the nations are going to be very important. You then have a genealogy that comes from Abraham. Tamar, I've got the signals. Rahab, Ruth, Bathsheba, all the four women mentioned in the genealogy, and they're all foreign women or women with foreign connections, foreshadowing the blessing on the Gentiles. The gospel then ends, the gospel of Matthew, with the disciples being sent out to make disciples of all nations. So in other words, Abraham's a really big theme, and the blessing of the nations is a really big theme in Matthew's gospel. But there's another theme in Matthew's gospel, the theme of God's presence. Matthew 1 announces that Jesus is called Emmanuel, which means God with us. Matthew 18, Jesus says that where two or three are gathered, there he is in their midst. And then Christ, in the very last verse, says that he will be with the disciples to the end of the age. So in other words, the presence of Christ, the presence of God, is a theme in Matthew's gospel. How can humans have the presence of God? Matthew's gospel explains this in chapter 27, verse 46. Around the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" My God, why have you forsaken me?" Abraham was never abandoned by God. Christ was. And we can have God's presence in Christ, even as Abraham could have God's presence, precisely because Christ was abandoned by God for us. And that's the amazing message that's coming through. If you like, it's summed up in 2 Timothy 2:13. If we're unfaithful, he remains totally faithful. So God is the prime example of a friend. So why is Abraham called his friend and God not called Abraham's friend? I think C.S. Lewis gives us the best explanation. He says that two friends sit alongside each other, contemplating something else. Well, Abraham can be contemplating God. But what is God contemplating? He's not contemplating another person. He's contemplating his own beauty, his own glory, his own excellences from within himself. So as he sees from within his own nature, because the best view of God is from within his own nature, he invites Abraham to come farther up and farther in and to get a glimpse of his glory. There's so much friendship today which is superficial. If we want to exercise philia, the Bible is replete with examples of what friends should not be. But these negative examples should not put us off. Friendship's too important for that. And looking at the real faithfulness of God as portrayed in the Bible will give us the very best picture we can have of what a true friend should be. God may only have had one friend, but you and I are here today because he did a really good job on the friendship. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Peter. We have time for some questions.